first lecture we have looked at about the upper limits of the parameters, current, voltage. Now we will go into the details of design, which we want to design to get the higher current, higher voltage, higher fill factor. Optical losses, I told you that there is a loss because of the reflection from the front metal. There is a this metal itself is causing a loss, right? Because the metal is there, it is not allowing light to come from this place. That is called the shadow losses and the transmission. So we want to minimize this. First thing we want to do is put what is called anti-reflective coating. We want to minimize the light reflected from the front surface, and therefore we should do what is called anti-reflective coating or ARC. The principle is very simple, that if your light is reflected from this surface and for the anti-reflective coating ARC design. So what you want, this is your PN junction solar cell. Okay, now you want to put another layer called ARC. Why you want to put this ARC? You want to put this ARC so that your light reflected is minimum. So the light can be reflected from here, or it can come down and get reflected from here. The simple way to minimize the reflection is to create a situation in which these two reflected rays, one is from the top surface and one is from this surface, results in a destructive interference. What is the destructive interference? If you have you put the two waves out of the 180 degrees phase shift. Okay, so wave which is reflected from this surface, top of the ARC, and wave which is reflected from the N surface, if these two waves are having 180 degree phase shift, you can create a destructive interference. Okay, so when you create a destructive interference, you have to create a interference. You have to create a phase shift. What does it mean? If this distance traveled by this ray within this layer is equal to the half of the wavelength. Okay, if this much distance is traveled in the ARC, let me draw it little bit in detail. So this is your ARC layer. Sorry, this is your ARC layer, and this is your N type. So if this distance traveled, this distance from here to here and here to here, if this is equal to half the wavelength, then if this is equal to half the wavelength, then you have the destructive interference. Okay, so that is first of all, that is what will happen. So this sum of these two paths should be half from here. So sum of these two paths should be half, right? Okay. So what should be the thickness of anti-reflective coating? Because this is traveling twice the distance, I should have one half of the thickness of this distance traveled. Okay. So typically, my thickness of anti-reflective coating should be 1/4. 1/4 of what? Wavelength. Which wavelength? At which I want minimum. I want minimum reflection. Okay. So this is 1/4 of lambda. If the wavelength outside the material is lambda, then when the light enters in the material, the wavelength becomes lambda by n. What is the n? N is the refractive index. Therefore, the thickness d is equal to lambda by n 1/4. That is what you see. So the thickness of anti-reflective coating should be lambda 0. Lambda 0 is the wavelength of the photon divided by 4 n 1. Okay, is it clear why the concept 4 came here? Because the d is the half wavelength, and that is why this 1/4 is coming here. One problem with this design is that, you know, your anti-reflective coating is a function, the thickness of the anti-reflective coating is a function of wavelength, and there are many wavelengths. So therefore, for each wavelength your coating thickness should be different, which you cannot afford. So therefore, you should minimize, you should choose the thickness of the anti-reflective coating such that the reflection is minimum where the intensity is higher. Okay, because d is a function of lambda, your d is the thickness of ARC. Thickness of ARC is a function of lambda. So lambda, uh, So your thickness is a function of lambda n. So because for every different wavelength, your thickness should be different. So where, so for what wavelength you should minimize? So minimize for the, so if I look at the spectrum, it is like this, right? So about green light or about 550 nanometer, your intensity is higher, and therefore you should design, so this is your spectrum which is high, intensity is higher here about 550 nanometer green photon, therefore you should design your thickness value for 550 nanometer. The one good problem that you will do in tutorial, and you can get in the quiz also. So we will not go into the details of the design, you know, so I will consider three values here. The reflection is minimum, so N0 is the refractive index of air, N1 is the refractive index of your ARC layer, N2 is the refractive index of silicon, okay, glass. This N0 can be glass, right, because in actually your solar cell is encapsulated between glass and ARC. So in practice you have your solar cell, you have the glass is used for encapsulation, then you have your ARC, then you have your semiconductor p-n junction, right. So if the refractive index of this layer is N0, if the refractive index of this layer is N1 and N2, then what it shows here, N1 should be, that is the refractive index of your middle layer should be equal to square root of N0 N2. Okay, refractive index of the glass is 1.5, refractive index of silicon is 3.8, and therefore square root of 1.5 into 3.8 is about 2. So therefore refractive index of your anti-reflective coating should be about 2, okay, right. So N1 is square root of N0 N2, which is 1.5 times 3.8, and you will do the calculation, it comes about 2. Okay. So you should choose a anti-reflective coating which should have a refractive index of about 2. Okay. Look at here, if you have bare silicon, your reflection is very high. If you have silicon under glass, reflection is given by the blue light, and if you have anti-reflective coating, then your reflection for a particular wavelength can really be minimized. Okay. That is what is the role of anti-reflection coating, to minimize the reflection, not all the wavelength, but for one particular wavelength where intensity is higher. Okay. So what is this anti-reflective coating that we used in practice? There is a material called silicon nitride, Si3N4. Silicon nitride is the most commonly used anti-reflective coating in commercial silicon solar cell, even in the laboratory solar cell. People use silicon nitride because it has a refractive index of about 2. So silicon nitride is the most commonly used anti-reflective coating. And in fact, the blue layer of your solar cell, is basically because of the silicon nitride. The blue color when you look at the solar cell is basically because of the silicon nitride. Okay. So one way to minimize the reflection is to put anti-reflective coating. You have this anti-reflective coating where else? In your sunglasses, sometime you have the anti-reflective coating, right? Wherever you want to minimize the reflection, you should have anti-reflective coating. Other way to minimize the reflection is texturing. Okay, you make your surface rough. Other way to minimize the reflection is texturing. And this is how people will do the texturing. The advantage of texturing is, first of all, ray will come here. If it is the case, some of the ray may get reflected directly, it can, in this case, when the surface is textured or the rough, it can also go here, and there is a one more chance of absorption, right. So therefore, texturing reduces the chances of reflection. And people do the texturing very nicely in the practice, and it's very easy. Crystalline silicon is very easy to texture. Anybody can do, even you at your center can do. Take a potassium hydroxide KOH, okay, put in a water, heat it at about 80 degree centigrade, put your silicon, crystalline silicon, monocrystalline silicon, and once you come out and take it, you will get textured within 5 to 10 minutes. It happens automatically. Because we have not discussed the crystal details, so once we know the crystal details, actually it is possible to explain how texturing is occurring. But it is very easy to do, and this crystal, this size of the crystals, that anybody can do depends on the on the crystal. So typically you will get this kind of pyramids after the crystallization. So this is all silicon, this is all silicon, and typically this height of the pyramids will be about 5 micrometer, and this also be about 5 micrometer typically. Okay, can be smaller and higher. So this happens automatically. Okay, very easy to do, put your silicon. But some of the texturing like this, which is called inverted pyramid, this is pyramid and this is this this is a pyramid and this is inverted pyramid. So this kind of pyramids require photolithography, will not go, but this is the way to minimize the reflection. And you can see, because of this, the light which come here, if it is not absorbed, it actually reflected, and if it is it will have second chance to get absorption. Okay, it will have second chance to get absorbed and the reflection reduces. Okay, there are many ways you can the other way is called the light trapping. Suppose, okay, fine, you may minimize the reflection, but what about this light, what about this light which is coming here and now passing by? This is possible, right? Because actual material thickness may be very high, the transmission is taking place. But what you want is, if you can somehow make this light also reflected, right, you make your backside also rough, you make your backside also rough, so that this light is further reflected, then what you are doing, you are trapping the light. What you are doing, you are trapping the light, light trapping. And light trapping is very important research area, particularly for thin film solar cell. Why? Because you want to minimize the thickness of your material for the cost reason. Whenever you use less thickness, your cost of the solar cell is lower, fabrication is lower. So you want to minimize the thickness whenever it is possible. And if you want to minimize, you do not want to compromise with the absorption, you still want to absorb more. And the one way to increase the absorption is through the light trapping, reflection from the front side and back side, so that your light keeps on bouncing back in front. This concept is called the light trapping, and very important for thin film and even for the crystalline silicon solar cell also. So as you can see here, if you get the total internal reflection, you can get the very well nicely trapped light. Fine. So you want to minimize the reflection. So reflection is like this. You do the anti-reflective coating as well as anti-reflective texturing. By the two things we do to minimize the reflection, texturing and coating. So now your emitter that I was showing all the way, your concept is now upside down, right? What is the thickness of the N layer I told you? What is the thickness of the N layer I told you? 300 to 500 nanometer, right? That is the thickness of emitter. What is the thickness of this pyramids? 5 micrometer, huge, as compared to 500 nanometer, 5 micrometer, 1000 times higher. What does it mean? That you are actually, what does it mean is that your emitter is not flat. So if you have wow, isn't it interesting? And then your backside. So actually your N region is like this and your P region is like this. N region is very thin, and because of the texturing you get this. And what else is there on the top? So this is your N region. What else is there on the top? On the top you also have anti-reflective coating. Okay, you also have what is called ARC. What is the thickness of ARC? Let us find out. Thickness of ARC layer should be lambda 0 by 4n. Okay, what is lambda 0 where you want to minimize the reflection? Let us say at 600 nanometer 4, and the refractive index is for the silicon nitride is 2. So 600 divided by 8, what do you get? You will get about 80 nanometer. So your anti-reflective coating is even thinner. How much is this? Anti-reflective coating thickness is 80 nanometer only. In industry you get anti-reflective coating of silicon nitride which is only 70 to 80 nanometer. Your ARC is only 70 to 80 nanometer. What is this material? Silicon nitride. What is its refractive index? 2. How we calculated the thickness? we calculate the thickness using the wavelength where we want minimum reflection. Where we want minimum reflection? Where there is the highest intensity. Where is the highest intensity? About 550 to 600 nanometer. So, if you want to minimize reflection at 900 nanometer, you can do that, you can choose it. So, this is how your interreflective coating thickness is only about 70 to 80 nanometer. And your solar cell structure is like this. Your solar cell structure is like this, okay. So, your junction is not anymore flat. Your junction is in commercial silicon solar cell, your junction is not flat. Interesting, wow. So, I'll give some more concepts about the design of solar cell, okay. Now, we want to minimize the recombination. How to minimize the recombination? First of all, where so far so good, reflection we had studied. Now, recombination is another thing. Remember, what are the two main things in a solar cell design? Increase absorption, reduce recombination. Two mantras: increase absorption, reduce recombination. Increase absorption means low reflection. Reduce recombination means low recombination. Where recombination can occur? Everywhere. On the front surface, in the emitter, in the junction, in the base, in the backside, everywhere recombination can occur, and we want to minimize this. Whether the recombination is taking place or not, who will tell us? Quantum efficiency. Quantum efficiency tell me where, whether the recombination is taking place or not. For example, if the quantum efficiency is low at 400 nanometer, because the 400 nanometer is the high energy photon, they get absorbed very close to the surface, it indicates that the recombination is taking place. If a quantum efficiency is high, indicates that recombination is not taking place. And same thing with other we have discussed in the last lecture. If the quantum efficiency high at given location means no recombination or less recombination taking place. If the quantum efficiency is low at a given place, indicates high recombination is taking place. Limit for short circuit current we already discussed, 46 milliampere per centimeter square. In practice, in silicon solar cell we get, in practice in crystalline silicon solar cell commercially we get about 30 to 38 milliampere per centimeter square, a number to remember. A number to remember that in crystalline silicon solar cell the efficiencies that we get is about 30 to 38 milliampere, I am sorry. In crystalline silicon solar cell, the current density, short circuit current density we get is about 30 to 38 milliampere per centimeter square. Design for high open circuit, okay. So, if you want to minimize the, recombination at the surfaces, so minimize recombination at surface, we do something what is called the surface passivation. Passivate the surface. Passivation means make it calm, quiet, that is called the passivation, pacify, right. If person is very violent, how do you pacify? Char log usko jaake pakad lete hain. So, if the surface is very active and lot of recombination is taking place, how to pacify? You put some other material. And silicon nitride, which is the anti-reflective coating, you actually put a silicon nitride, which is the anti-reflective coating, also acts as a surface passivation layer. It also pacifies. How to get high open circuit voltage? Again, minimize the recombination as we discussed earlier, because your open circuit voltage, depends on log of IL divided by I0 plus 1. Okay, I0 is a reverse saturation current. Reverse saturation current depends on many parameters. So, one way to minimize the recombination is to minimize the reverse saturation current. And then many people were asking, you know, how to minimize the reverse saturation current, how to minimize the recombination. And many people were asking yesterday about the doping. What is the optimum doping? If doping can be 10^14 atom, 15 atom, 10^16, 17, what is the optimum doping? So, open circuit voltage sets the limit for the optimum doping, okay. And then we have to actually go into discuss detail in theory and find out why the doping level has to, again there is a compromise between doping level, okay. We want in some, for some cases we want low, high doping. High doping basically will result in a, okay. So, I want, what about the doping? I want high doping. High doping will give me low RS, will give me low series resistance. okay. But high doping will give me, high doping will give me what? More defects, right? More defects means more recombination, okay. High doping will give me more recombination and it also give me lower diffusion length, lower diffusion length. So, therefore, contradiction, right? I cannot have I want high doping for lower series resistance, but I cannot have high doping for, because my recombination will increase and diffusion length will also decrease, and lower diffusion means lower collection. I want diffusion length to be as long as possible, right? So then you have to make a compromise between the diffusion length. Okay. So this theory explains, and we are not going to the detail, why we should have not very high doping level and not very low doping level. So typically, the doping level in p type base, doping level in p type base is normally about 10^15 to 10^16 boron atoms per centimeter cube, typically in commercial silicon solar cell. Base doping level is 10^15 to 10^16. N type emitter have very high doping level, right? 10^18 to 10^19 phosphorus atom per centimeter cube. Why like this? Emitter doping is much higher than the base doping. Base doping is lower because of the higher open circuit voltage. Emitter doping has to be higher because we really want lower resistance. I will discuss about that. Okay. So, high open circuit voltage you means minimize the surface recombination. How to minimize the surface recombination? You put an anti-reflective coating. At the front side, I will take another slide. So, surface recombination front side, I put silicon nitride. By the way, I am showing you the flat surface, but you know now that surfaces in reality are not flat, they are textured. But in only for the simplicity, but the back side we do very nice thing. Okay, so this is the front side, this is the front side. At the back side we do what is called back surface field. At the back side what we do? Back surface field, or we call BSF. BSF to minimize the recombination at the back side, and the passivation, surface passivation is to minimize the recombination at the back front side, passivation. Okay, so we want to minimize the recombination both the front side and back side. At the back side we do what is called the back surface field. We create another layer which is called the PP plus layer. Okay, we create at the back side P plus layer. P plus is more doping. Okay, look at your structure now. Your solar cell is actually, I told you emitter is highly doped, so N plus, not N. High, okay, when you in our terminology, when we say P and P plus, we means high doping. Okay. Okay, so normal terminology is P is doping and then P plus is heavy doping. N is a medium doping and N plus is heavy doping, that is the terminology. So, what is your solar cell becoming now? Your solar cell is N plus P and P plus. Okay, your solar cell is what? N plus P and P plus. N plus is your emitter, P is your base, and you have smaller P plus at the back side, that is the front surface. Okay, this is a solar cell I am showing you, this is where the light will enter. This is my emitter. This is my base and this is my BSF, back surface field, and then I will make a contact here and I will make a contact here. Okay. I am showing a solar cell in a different way just to show you what are the different reasons. Emitter is clear that it is N type, only thing is I am telling you that it is heavily doped. Okay. To minimize the, when we do more doping there are more electrons, when there are more electrons the conductivity is higher and resistivity is lower. So when we heavy doping is there to minimize the resistance, and I will come back to why. P doping cannot be very high because my open circuit voltage will reduce because the recombination will increase. So P is normal, but the back side my doping is again higher, P plus. Why it is higher? Because I want to create a back surface field, and the back surface field is created very nicely. When doping is higher, your Fermi level is closer to the valence band. When doping is lower, so P layer and P plus layer. When doping is lower, your Fermi level is little away from the valence band. And now you see here the bands are flat, here the bands are flat, and in this region band is not flat. So whenever there is a change in potential energy, means what? Potential energy is not constant. Change in potential energy means electric field. Okay, so therefore there is electric field, and therefore this electric field for electron will actually act as a repellent. It will not allow electron, and which is my electron here, which is the important carrier? Minority, because in P type minority carrier is more important. In P type, what is, which is the minority? Electron. So the avoiding recombination of electron is more important, and therefore back surface field will minimize the recombination at the back surface. So then we have created the back surface field. So now look at how we are going. We are designing a solar cell which is now having a texturing, which is having anti reflective coating, and it is also having a back surface field. Okay, fine. So now we are actually trying to do the minimize the recombination. And the last important, third and last important thing is anti reflective coating and texturing is for increasing the current. We want more electron photon to go in. Surface passivation is there to minimize the recombination because we want higher open circuit voltage from it. And residue losses we want to minimize because we want to get the higher fill factor from it. Okay. So very interesting. This is a model of a solar cell. Okay, and I'll show you how to get a model of a solar cell. So what is your solar cell? Your solar cell is a PN junction diode. Very nice. You put a light on it, and because of light, it gets positive and you get negative. Okay, you get a positive and negative, and then the current flows in this direction, reverse direction. Okay, this is your solar cell. Look at how I make a model of it. I want to make a model of this solar. I want to represent this model. Okay, remember one thing: this is current due to the light. This is the current due to the light. Because of my P side is positive, N side is negative, it is also getting forward bias. And if PN junction is forward bias, will the forward bias current will flow? If my PN junction is forward bias, will the current in forward direction flow or not? Yes, it will flow. Why? Because if it is a junction, it is a PN junction, it is getting forward bias, so it should go flow the forward bias current. Only thing is forward bias current is smaller. So this is my current. What current? Forward bias current. Okay. Other than this, because my device will have finite resistance, it will have finite resistance, right? So I should add somewhere the resistance also. What is this? This is my series resistance. So now how to make it? So what are the things? I have one current source which is function of light. This current. I have a current which is function of bias, and I have resistance. So if I draw a current source, and this is because of the light, and my diode current is flowing in the opposite direction of this current, right? My diode current, forward bias current, flows in P to N. My light current flows from N to P. So therefore, my diode current should be in the opposite direction. Okay, this is my current, and there is a resistance in the path. So this is my series resistance. Okay. And sometime there can be what is called the shunt resistance also, shunt resistance RSH. So now this is my diode, my IV. So V, and here I have the I. This is my IL. This is my IL, and this is my diode current. Got it? So in a very nice way, whatever we understood from what we understood from the, this is the cell model. What we understood from the theory so far, using that theory, I can very easily draw the model of a solar cell, okay, model of a solar cell. It should be the easy, very easy job for all of you now, right? It should be the very easy job for all of you now to draw the model. Forward current of a diode and light generated current, series resistance, shunt resistance. Okay, based on this, you can actually modify your IV characteristic of a solar cell. Okay, what is IV characteristic? Now, I have taken IL as a positive current. Okay, you can take anything. Because of this, I have taken IL, light generated current, as a positive current. Okay. So, normally you have I equal to IL minus I 0 e raised to power kV by kT minus 1. Light generated current, forward bias current, and IV is the bias that is getting. Okay. This is the normal thing. This equation do not take care of the series and shunt into account, series and shunt into account. But in this equation, you can do that. How we can do that? Your voltage appearing here will be voltage V plus IRS, okay, V plus IRS loss here. So, here the V term will get modified as V plus IRS. Now, you have another current component here. If this voltage is V plus IRS and then the current in this divided by V plus IRS by divided by RSH, right, as we have seen yesterday here. So, you can actually modify your current IL minus I 0, your voltage term will modify because of the series resistance drop that will occur by kT minus 1, but you are adding one more current component, which is because of the shunt resistance possibly. Okay. So, voltage drop is V plus IRS divided by the RSH, shunt resistance. So, now this is your new modified current voltage equation of a real solar cell, which has a finite series resistance and which has a finite shunt resistance. And what is our job? Our job is to make RS as small as possible. The resistance of the device should be as small as possible. And we do not want this current component. Why? Because this is an opposite direction of light generated. So, this current component should be as small as possible. And therefore, RSH, the shunt resistance should be as high as possible. Typically, ideally 0, and they should be infinity. Simple? Simple. So, this is your new characteristic of the IV characteristic. Now, the series resistance is a function of many parameters. So, the resistance of the base, resistance of the emitter. Look at first of all how the current is flowing. This is another important point you should note. And in fact, you will realize that everything that I am teaching is important. Okay. So, another point that you should note, how the current flows. Where is my contact? My contact is here. My contact is here. Metal contact and my back contact is everywhere. Okay. Front surface is actually textured, and you know that very well. So, if my electron is generated here, and this is my P and this is my N, electron is generated here, how it will travel? It will travel like this, because the perpendicular to the cross section area, it will face minimum resistance. If it has to travel here, then its resistance is higher unnecessarily. So, actually it will go here. Once it goes here, it has to either go to this contact or this contact. So, it will either go like this and like this, it will go like this and like this. So, very important, current flows vertically in the base, and horizontally in the emitter. Current flows vertically in the base and horizontally in the emitter. So, this explains why your emitter has to be heavily doped. But I told you, what is the thickness of the emitter? I am repeating again and again, 300 to 500 nanometer. Your thickness of emitter is 300 to 500 nanometer, very thin layer, very thin layer. And therefore, if this current flows, lot of current flows in that direction, lot of current flows in this direction, resistance will be higher. And therefore, in order to minimize the resistance, you should increase the doping level. And therefore, normally the emitter doping, that is why I told you the emitter doping is 10 to the power 18 to about 10 to the power 19 phosphorus type, and base doping is about 10 to the power 15 to 10 to the power 16. Boron, and this is phosphorus per centimeter cube, boron per centimeter cube. Okay. So, that is one reason why your emitter should be heavily doped. Other reason is that if you make heavy doping, your defects will increase, and your diffusion length will decrease, no problem, because your thickness of emitter is only 300 nanometers. Even if your diffusion length comes from 100 micrometer to 2 micrometer, 5 micrometer, you do not care because your emitter is very, very thin. So, current flows like this, then it flows like this, and then it gets collected by the fingers, and then all the fingers are connected to what is called the bus bar, and your bus bar carries the current, your bus carries the current. Okay. So, because the time is over, let me stop here. Some of this design about the series resistance and the fill factor I will discuss tomorrow. We are running out of the time. Some of the slides I will discuss tomorrow before we starting the next lecture. Okay. So, before I stop, let me summarize what we have discussed in this design of a solar cell. We particularly looked at to increase the short circuit current by minimizing the reflection. So, we have looked at the anti-reflective coating, and actually you can calculate the thickness of the anti-reflective coating. An anti-reflective coating is based on the concept of destructive interference. And then we looked at about the texturing and the pyramids that is formed. Then we have looked at about the minimizing open circuit voltage by minimizing the recombination at the front surface and the back surface. Front surface recombination is minimized by putting a passivation layer, and I told you that anti-reflective coating silicon nitride also not only acts as a anti-reflective coating, but it also acts as a passivation layer. And the backside recombination is reduced by what is called the back surface field. Okay, I also told you that emitter has to be heavily doped. So, the symbol for heavy doping is called N plus. N is a medium doping, 10 to the 15, 16. N plus is a heavy doping, 10 to the 18, 19. Then you have the base, which is P type, and the backside is again P plus layer, which is heavily doped because of the back surface formation. And then we started discussing about the series resistance and shunt resistance. We have looked at the model of a solar cell, very interesting model of a solar cell. From whatever discussed, we have discussed very easily, simply, we can actually make the model of the solar cell, considering a solar cell as a current source and the forward bias current, series and shunt resistance. Based on that, you can modify the IV equation of a solar cell and get the right equation. And then we started looking at the series resistance minimization. One way to minimize the series resistance is increase the doping of the emitter, because emitter is very thin. Again, the current flows vertically in the base and horizontally in the emitter. So, thank you very much. We will stop here. I see there are a lot of questions. So, I will take as many questions possible. So, first question goes to Jaipur College, Kukas.
Hello, sir. Sir, at what point of time in your discussion you mentioned that the wind speed also affect the performance of a battery or a solar cell. Could you please explain how does the wind speed affects the efficiency of a solar cell?
What affects the efficiency of solar cell?
Wind speed.
Okay, wind speed actually will not affect the efficiency of the solar cell. Wind speed will result in a cooling of a solar cell in a module. And when the wind is higher, the cooling will be higher and temperature will be little bit lower. And that, because the temperature will be lower, it can affect the efficiency. Otherwise, it will not. It will have effect of cooling. Amrita Coimbatore.
Can we plot to the optical losses to zero level?
In the practical, when anything doing 0 and 100% are, you know, very difficult. Right? Anything doing 0 and 100% is very difficult. So, bringing to 0 is nearly impossible.
From a previous chapter, so our light causes both the currents, diffusion and drift currents. So, the diffusion current causes by our photon. So, and the phonon acts some a role. So, what is that phonon?
In a phonon, in an indirect band gap semiconductor, without phonon absorption, the photon cannot get absorbed, you know, because in silicon like material, if an electron is going from valence band to conduction band, it has to change its energy level and it has to change its momentum, then only absorption is complete. So, photon is coming, it is giving energy, and phonon is coming, it is.
Okay, thank you, sir.
SVNIT Surat.
Hello. This terminology, emitter and base, though it is a diode, we feel that when emitter base is there, whether there is a collector too. Is there any significance of in using this terminology?
Yes, the terminology of emitter base actually comes from the transistor only. That's why emitter and base terminology is adopted from the transistor, but there is no collector here.
Okay. And one more question, sir, whether I don't know it is relevant or not, in order to have perfect like less transmission losses and resistive losses, the reason for which are basically the difference in the band gap energy and the energy of the light waves, wavelength,
right.
Rather.
Right.
So, whether right. there is anything like modulation or conversion of this energy range, any device, whether it is available or whether there is an area of research, because I mean using which we can convert all these to around 1.45 electron volts and get the maximum, be it any wavelength.
Very nice question that if the whole problem of this transmission and distribution losses is about the difference in the photon energy and the band gap energy, why not to convert all the photons to a band gap energy? And this kind of change in energy, photon energy, is what some people are looking at, and this terminology is called up conversion and down conversion. So people are trying to convert high energy photons into low energy photons and low energy photons into high energy photons, so that you know you can use single material to do that. There is not lot of success so far, but yes, what you are saying is a very correct idea, that if you can convert all the photons, all the spectrum into one particular photon, it can be useful. Partly it is done in what is called the thermophotovoltaics. In thermophotovoltaics, solar energy is first converted into thermal energy of higher temperature, let us say 2000 Kelvin, and then whatever the spectrum is generated may be close to the band, solar cell band gap, and can do more efficient job. Baramati.
Terminal voltage is positive and electric field is opposite to that in the band, how this happens that terminal voltage is positive, P is positive, N is negative, then also in the band gap, in the W, electric field is in opposite direction.
No, actually make sure that you are understanding correctly, the potential energy of the electron and the potential is minus, there is a minus sign involved. So if you look at the band diagram carefully, you will see that generated voltage is actually what is appearing at the terminal. So look at the band diagram carefully, look at the signs of energy of electrons carefully, and you will find out the answer. Amrita, school, Kollam.
You have given two expressions for finding fill factor, and you said that when VOC increases, fill factor increases. But when we consider the expression, when VOC increases, it is evident that fill factor decreases.
No, so that VOC, by the way, VOC in the expression is not VOC, it is VOC normalized to, it's a small VOC, small VOC normalized to KT by Q. That is what you should plot. Okay. So, in the expression, let me tell you, in the expression you should use VOC normalized to KT by Q, and that is small VOC. So, this is what you should use in the expression, then I think you will not have this problem.
Sir, if the light is made to fall on P region of the solar cell, then will the direction of current reverse?
No, direction of current will not reverse. Wherever light is falling, direction of current is because of the whatever the energy arrangement of the P and N region. Wherever light comes from, the direction of the current will always be in the negative direction, that is N to P. Always the direction of light generated current will always be from N to P, irrespective of the direction from where the current light is falling. PVPS Institute, Vijayawada.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Yes.
Sir, why we are taking always N-type as a top layer, sir?
I think I have explained you that it's a more like for a technological reason. when we take n type as a top layer, you know, top surface, we have to minimize the recombination, we have to passivate the surface. And people have found that it is easier to passivate the n layer as compared to p layer. And that is why we use top layer as a n layer. Second reason is, you know, p layer is very thick and my minority carriers in the base is electron, and electrons have higher mobility as compared to holes, and electron will have to travel higher distances. Therefore, it is better that electrons are used in the as a conducting medium in the p layer, minority carriers, and for this reason we always use n as a top. But this is not the only possibility, there are researchers who are trying to use otherwise also. You can use p layer as a top, n layer as a bottom also, but commercially n is on the top, p is on the bottom.
Sir, my another question is, we know photoelectric effects, so whenever light falls on some metal surface, electrons emits from that surface, sir. So is it possible in case of these photovoltaic cells? That means whenever electrons comes out, the number of charge carriers number also decreases, that also affects the efficiency. Is it possible, sir?
Photoelectric effect is not possible considering our solar spectrum, right? Solar spectrum has certain energy. Photoelectric effect is when high energy electron, when high energy photons falls on the material, electrons emits out. Okay, that happens when you have high energy X-rays are using. In solar spectrum, photoelectric effect will not occur. It is only photovoltaic effect that will occur. Shastra University.
Good afternoon, sir. It is possible to make a modeling of a solar cell by using your SQL, sir?
Is it possible to model the solar cell using SQL? I think yes, it is possible to model SQL to model the solar cell. Yes, it is possible. Okay, let me take some chat questions. Why pentavalent or trivalent atoms are used for doping rather than using bivalent and hexavalent atom, etcetera? So when you want to do the doping, first of all we want to create extra electron and extra hole, that is the most important thing. But other than that, you have to make sure that how the doping is happening. When the doping is happening, this atom is actually going inside the crystal, right? Think you are already having a silicon material intrinsic, okay? Now you have to put one atom there. So this atom has to physically go. So the size of the dopant, if it is very small or very big as compared to your lattice spacing, then it will create a problem. So there are many other parameters that you have to see. What is the diffusion coefficient, at what temperature it diffuses, what is the size of the atom. If the size of the atom is different than the size of your bulk atom, then that will create a problem, and therefore other things have to be taken into account. Jaipur College.
So my question is, like photon of single light, like say red, all the photon of red light will be having the same energy. Then why it is absorbed in a different length in a semiconductor?
Okay, good question. Because all the photons of red light, if they have the same energy, why they get absorbed at a different length? Okay, so imagine that once it is entering inside the material, which is entering the semiconductor, it is going through the probability, right? So the photon will go, it will have some interaction. If this interaction is strong enough, it will get the energy from the photon and give it to the electron. Okay, so because this is statistical kind of a phenomena, so because, and it is probability, right? So when that interaction take place, can happen within certain distance, and that is why it is not only absorbed at one location, but it can absorb at different locations.
So like by passing from front to end layer, there may be a chance that it will be colliding with other atoms.
Right.
That red photon will give it energy to another electron. Sir, is it possible a single photon can excite more than one electron?
Normally, yes, in principle, it is possible to that single photon excite more than one electron. Some cases it has been observed, and that is what the phenomena we look forward. But in practice, if you look at the quantum efficiency analysis and other, normally it does not happen. Okay, but if the photon energy is twice the energy of the band gap, it is possible that it can actually give more than excitation to more than one electron. But normally it doesn't happen. Okay, question on chat. In p-type material, why the current moving in vertical direction, and n-type material, why the current is moving in the horizontal direction? You know, I told you that because in the horizontal direction, if you look at our, if you look at this explanation here, that now this current is moving in this direction because this is the shortest path and low resistance path for this photon, or this, sorry, this electron. This is the lowest resistance path, the vertical path, right? But once it goes there, because my contact is only sitting here and here, my contact is not everywhere. So once it goes here, then it has to move this direction. It has to move in this direction in order to get collected at the contacts, right? So for electron in the base, the lowest resistance path is like this, but in emitter, the resistance path is like this. And therefore, here it will move vertically and here it will move horizontally. Imagine that the thickness of the emitter is very thin, it is only 300 to 500 nanometer. It is very thin as compared to the distance. The distance between these two metal contact is of the order of millimeters, okay, 1000 micrometer, or it is 1000 nanometer. So as compared to this thickness, this width between the two contact is very, very high, and therefore the current will have to flow horizontally in the emitter. Shivaji Nagar.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, my question is regarding anti-reflecting coating. Thickness of anti-reflecting coating is such that it should give rise to destructive interference for reflected rays. So my question is, what is happening with the energy of reflected rays after destructive interference, because energy should get conserved?
Definitely, yes. So the destructive interference is occurring, and destructive interference means zero energy reflected, right? So nothing is reflected, so everything is going in. Another question from GSITS, is the current generated is negative, if not, how it is operated in the fourth quadrant? Of course, current generated is negative with respect to our convention. What is our convention? In a PN junction diode, we say that current flows from P side to N side, that we call it a positive current. In the solar cell, the current flows from N side to P side, and therefore, with respect to our convention, the current is negative. So, current will always flow negative, and then only you will have the power generation operation from a solar cell, okay. So, let me stop here. Thank you very much.